I was born and I grew up 50 kilometers here to the south, in the southern part of the Netherlands. And when I was 19 years old, I moved to Amsterdam to study. And already in the first week of my study, I lost my passport. And here in the Netherlands, when you lose your passport, you have to go to the police station in order to fill in a form, and that's needed in order to apply for a new one. So I went to the police station, to the reception desk, and there the officer listened very carefully to my story, and he said, you have to go upstairs. So I went upstairs, went up the stairs, and I was waiting in the queue, all kinds of people, all kinds of colors, sizes, ages. And finally, when I could enter the white office, I saw in the corner of my eye, I saw what we call in the Netherlands the aliens police, the vreemdelingenpolitie. I was a bit surprised, but Amsterdam is the capital, I was just there. So I went into the office and I spoke to the white officer again and I did my story and he said, and he laughed a bit and he said, I'm sorry. He said, I cannot give you the form. You cannot fill in this form because you have to prove that you are Dutch. The way you speak, you must be Belgian, you must be German, but certainly you are not Dutch. So this is my story, but of course many people all over the world can tell, they can tell the story. I moved from, so it's not unique, I moved from the south to the north, and in the north they would tell me, you are from the south. And when I'm in the south, they would tell me, you are from the north. So somewhere, linguistically, I'm stuck between places. Or, in other words, I'm out of place. So the first question I want to pose is, how come that the idea of a national language is so powerful that we imagine that speakers do not speak, that they don't differ, that they all speak the same? How come? When children go to school in the Netherlands, they carry along what I would call a backpack. And this backpack contains all the knowledge they have acquired at home. And in this backpack, there are a lot of languages. Because children in the Netherlands, they acquire at home a lot of languages in addition to Dutch. However, when the first time they go to school or to kindergarten, they are told to leave the backpacks behind at the entrance of the building. So they are not allowed to bring languages into the building, with the exception of Dutch and English, maybe, a bit. So what languages stay behind at the entrance? Arabic, Turkish, local dialects, Farsi, Swahili, all kinds of languages. So here's my second question. How come that in the Netherlands we like to raise young children as monolingual Dutch-speaking children? How come that a multilingual Dutch society is such a problem for us? That's two questions. Okay. Therefore, we have to go back into history. And this is a picture of Johann Gottfried Herder. Johann Gottfried Herder lived a long time ago, between 1744 and 1803. He had great ideas. He was a German philosopher. And one of his ideas was that what makes us humans human is the fact that there are language diversities between groups of speakers, between societies, and between nations. And this idea of him, these language diversities between, was taken up in the latter half of the 19th century when all the European nation-state formation took place. England, France, Italy, Germany, the Netherlands. And in that time, people came to live within new national borders. And they had to get used to it, that they were Dutch, or they were German, or they were French. And in order to bind these people, people thought the best way to bind these people, we have to find a glue, and the glue is language. And since that time, new phrases were found. The Dutch language was a new invention. The German language, or the English language, or Italian language, all new inventions. And that was all based on these ideas of Johann Gottfried Herder, that language is the essence of the nation, or language is a crucial ingredient for a national identity. So what does it mean from that moment on that there is a Dutch language? A Dutch language will say that it is fixed, it is stable, it doesn't change, it doesn't vary, all speakers speak the same, and more importantly, it is bounded. So you can really cut it through, and then on the other hand of other side of the national border, we speak German, and that's completely different than Dutch, what is spoken on the other side of the national border. So this is an idea, but of course, now we know with this idea, because from that moment on, national identity was expressed by the expression of one nation, one people, one language, one flag, and one anthem, everything one. So now we can understand why the Amsterdam police officer put me outside the Netherlands, because my Dutch was so different that according this view, you have to put someone who speaks different also in a different place. And now we can imagine or why we like to raise children in the Netherlands as monolingual Dutch children, because they have to fit in this idea of one nation, one national identity, one people, and of course multilingual people don't fit in this idea. However, since that time, there is a permanent link between a language, a place, and a speaker, and a national identity. And that's permanent in our idea. However, in order to maintain this idea, which is a new invention, relatively long, maybe 200 years, we have to do some sacrifices. The first sacrifice we have to do is that if people speak different, we put them in a different place. And that's why we ask in the Netherlands, when someone has a slightly different way of speaking, where do you come from? This is our question, due to the ideas of Johann Gottfried Herder and this European nation formation. And also, a second sacrifice is that we always focus on people in research, on people who stay, and we ignore all the people who are mobile. But we cannot do that anymore. This idea of one people, one nation, one language is problematic. Our societies are changing. People are on the move. They are on the move, they are mobile, they circulate because they have to move. They are forced to do so. They are leaving their countries. They have no other choice, or they want to do so. And people who are mobile, they speak in a way mobile. They have mobile ways of speaking. And with sometimes unexpected outcome. So these mobile speakers do not fit any longer in this idea of one people, one nation, one language. And that's problematic. If an invention is problematic and is outdated, it is outdated for our societies nowadays, we have to disinvent it. And how can we disinvent this idea? So what is the alternative? Instead of seeing language as something you can study and that's on the table or on the chair, we can think about language as a possession of the speakers and the situations they are in. And that it is an activity. Language is something that we do. We are doing language. And in the literature, a new verb has been invented, the verb languaging. And this is what we do, languaging, when we speak. And languages tries to express that people can combine words and also other linguistic elements associated with different languages. So here I'm going to read to you a perfect Dutch sentence. Ik reserveer een kamer via de computer op mijn bureau en betaal met Duco. So this is, let's say, an example of languaging. And here we see that our grandparents already did languaging, but we ignored it. For instance, the Dutch word kamer we do not recognize it anymore as that it stems from Latin, but it is a Latin word. Via as well. Computer is a Dutch word, stems from English. Duco is Surinamese, Rangantongo. We recognize that because it is very recent into the Dutch language. And we have the French, the Dutch words coming from French, reserveren and bureau. This is languaging. This is what we're doing unknowingly all the time, and this is what our parents and grandparents did as well, but that we ignored it all the time. So what is the benefit of languaging? If you accept that languaging is part of the speaker, it will open up our eyes. The first what is striking when thinking about the concept, whether you call it languaging or not, the first thing what is striking about that concept is that you can now see that language does not belong to a nation. Language belongs to speakers, and the people speakers speak with, and the interactions they have, and the context and situations they are in. So that's the first. The second one, we can value all these children with these other languages. Instead of ignoring the other languages of children, we can value them and we can admire them for the linguistic competence and all the languages and all the linguistic competence they have acquired at home. The third one is that if we accept languaging, then it is no longer unexpected or unpredictable that people born in the same place speak differently. We don't have to put people who speak different into another place. Now because it is unfixed from place, now we can expect that people speak different. In a place, whether it is a country, a region, a city, a street, a household with family members, or even an individual speakers, an individual speaker within certain situations. So here I can speak what is associated with English, but I can also speak Dutch here in the same place. So if we accept this taken together, then the conclusion is, and that's what I want to tell, is that no one ever is more out of place, and that's what we need in these fast-changing societies. Okay, thank you.